Paupers and Pig Killers, the life and times of William Holland, based on his diaries and dramatised for radio in three parts by Eric Pringle, with Ronald Pickup as William Holland and Rosemary Martin as Mary. Part 1, The Troubles of This Life.
The Vicarage, Overstowey, Somerset, October the 25th, 1799. A cold, sunshiny morning. This is my wedding day. When we're to have something better than ordinary for dinner? Mary and I were married 18 years to this day. Good God. Oh, time, how thou dost run on. Yet, alas, what improvements in virtue, what services rendered to my fellow creatures.
Robert, you booby, what are you doing with my horse? Strangling him? You're an ass.
William, don't you want your breakfast?
When I think of my God and how far short I come of what I might have been then, am I staggered. I must endeavour to grow better as I advance in years.
Robert, your Somerset barrel, your Quantock horse dropping!
Silence, little William!
He wants his breakfast.
He refused his breakfast before.
Now he wants it.
He's woefully undecisive. And must my daughter play the harpsichord while I compose my sermon?
You should write that in your study.
I'm trying to compose this one in my head.
I should give it up.
Where's Miss Dodwell?
Lying abed this morning.
Lying abed? Mary, I think if your cousin lay abed less and agitated herself more...
She may lie abed, I presume.
Indeed, she may do exactly as she wishes. And my little boy may bang his spoon and my daughter her harpsichord and you may sing and Robert may sulk and Mr. Amen may drag his heels about the glebe and the farmers may grudge me their tithes and the Duke of York may disgrace the British arms in Holland and make me sick. But Overstowey is my parish, and this is my vicarage, and yet I may not compose a sermon in my head.
William, you are at war with the world.
Who? Me?
And I have no idea what you're talking about.
Little William
is our little miracle. God's blessing on us. And this is our wedding day, so let us have harmony, husband, can we?
Parson Holland, sir. Mistress Holland.
Good morning, Mr. May. How are your wife's carbuncles getting on? I'll send you some of my strong beer to strengthen her.
I thank you, Parson, for thy kindness.
Parson? Parson, you ass. I wish these Somersetshire folk would speak English.
Like a Welshman, you mean?
I'm surrounded by foreigners.
William, you have been vicar of Overstowey Parish for 20 years and Monkton Farley for 14. All our children were born in Somerset.
Four died in Somerset in a fortnight.
In Monkton Farley. We won't speak of that today. We've been back in Overstowey a year now.
If we hadn't left...
Margaret is a fine young lady and our son is...
Look out, here's Thomas Poole. If that patron of Democrats speaks to us, I'll not answer.
You will be polite. Good morning, Mr. Poole.
Mrs. Holland, madam. And Parson Holland. Good to see you in Netherstowey on such a fine morning.
Is it?
William.
Sir, God smiles on us on such a day.
Who's God, sir? Yours or mine?
Why, Parson, the same God, surely. Our God, a little tolerance.
My husband jokes, Mr. Poole.
Of course he does. And isn't he the joker in our Quantock pack? Well, there's room in the garden for Welsh leeks as well as English roses, for dictators as well as Democrats, for the established church as well as Methodists. What say you, Parson?
I'm speechless.
I wish you pleasure of your tongue when it returns. Good day to you both.
Good day, Mr. Poole.
Ah, Welsh leek around your English ears.
Charity, William. There's Mr. Frank bowing to us.
For it is in his heart.
this Sunday, my sermon concerns the heathen French, that godless foe of our glorious king and country, and Methodists, and dissenters, and Catholics, and Democrats. What's the connection, you ask? I'll tell you. There isn't a halfpenny to split between them. All nip and sting the natural ordered body of this land, and anybody who says different is an ass! Monday, October 28th. I warmed their ears in church yesterday, and in a moment I will clatter Miss Dodwell's. She sleeps late yet again. This day I shall finish carrying my tithe barley, which now sells at 6 shillings a bushel. I never remember anything like it. There's a great bustle out in the yard where that useful man William Frost and my parish clerk carry apples to the cart for cider.
He wants them squeezed through air cloths, wrung out.
Apples, wrung out? Nah. Did he ever hear the like?
Morning, Mr. Frost.
Yes, sir.
You were in fine voice yesterday, Mr. Amen.
Thank you, sir.
And these are fine cider apples, are they not?
And fine cider will come out of them, Parson, if they're properly ground in press at Mr. Early's.
They are to be squeezed. Now, you'll take them to Hewlett's to make the cider through hair cloth.
But, sir,
it may not be the fashion of this county, Frost, but Somerset knows nothing of making cider.
No. Sir, you be a Welsh
and
man.
You're a blockhead, Mr. Armin. You Somerset people are of a large size and strong, but slow and lazy and discontented and humoursome and very much given to eating and drinking. See to it.
Also see to it, sir. He's a man of God, let him get himself in pulpit. What's he know about cider?
What's he know about my name? What's he call me, Mr. Amen? Name's Pettit, William Pettit. Oh, I shall tell him. Amen's a faddy sort of title for a man.
Right, up we go.
Miss Dodwell, thou hast arisen.
I have been up betimes, William, and I wish to speak with you.
No time, Miss Dodwell, I have things to do.
I visited the workhouse yesterday to give poor Betty Pierce a new stiff petticoat.
This house is full of wagging female tongues, clack from morning to night. A man in a house full of women is worse off than Daniel in the lion's den. Goodbye, Miss Dodwell.
I am trying to speak with you, William.
What about?
Madman.
Madman?
There is a madman in the workhouse. His name is Porter.
Well, I know Porter. He's no more mad than I am.
Then you should be incarcerated.
Oh, look out there. Robert Wheels, dung like a snail.
I said I would speak to you about him.
About Robert?
About Porter.
Did you know the French papers are making a great noise about the return of Bonaparte?
Porter was making a great noise about himself. He was cursing.
One of the Miss Chesters has died, still young, not ill, above 10 days.
Now, some of the workhouse women are concerned he may turn violent.
Poor girl, her state of probation was soon over.
Oh, that will be another burial for you to perform. This is a veil of tears, William.
Indeed it is, Miss Dodwell.
With madmen in it.
Here's one. The apothecary has come.
Mr. Holland, sir.
Look at Lewis, rubbing his hands like Shylock, and that retreating chin popping in and out of his stock like a piston. Mr. Lewis!
Mr. Holland, sir. I have come to ask if you will perform the service at Aeschult tomorrow.
Can Rector Reeks not perform his own duty?
Mr. Reeks is incapable.
Can he not be sobered up by tomorrow? You usually get him stood up.
'Tis a bad case this time, Mr. Holland.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.